Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Coronagate day 106. Wow, it seems so big when we get past that 100 mark, doesn't it? I hope you guys are having a really good week so far. It's only been a day in a bit, but it depends. If you start your week on a Sunday, then it'll be 2 days in a bit. I've been going back into school this week with some of the children who've wanted to come back, and I felt it safe enough to do so. I've just been doing some work with them. So it's been really nice to see some of my children. I know other things are changing. You know, at the end of this week, different rules are changing again, and there's a bit more freedom. So I guess in some way, some things feel like they're going back to normal, but still, I still think things are just weird, really, still, aren't they? And you might feel that too, or maybe everything seems like it's come back to normal for you as well. As you're watching this, this was pre-recorded last night, so if I keep saying tonight, then I mean to say this morning. It's just because I will be at work by the time most of you guys will be watching this, and I thought that it'd be good to keep it on at the same time of 8:30 for you guys. That's why it's premiered this morning. But it doesn't mean you still can't comment in, and I will certainly look at those later. I'm sure others who are watching it alongside you will be able to look at those comments too. So it'd be really great if you kept engaging in that as well as we go through this psalm. So today we are looking at Psalm 17, and this is another lament of David. You know, most of the psalms we've looked at so far have been laments, and the main theme of this is protection of God in the shadow of your wings, your being God. And it's a psalm asking God for vindication, you know, basically to be cleared of blame and for what he'd been accused of. David felt unjustly accused of trying to take Saul's throne and even Saul's own life. And David is lamenting at this injustice and this desire for being vindicated. And one of the parts of the psalm I want to really focus in on is about, you know, difficult and painful circumstances as David finds himself in here. So I thought this morning, if you wanted to comment in, something to answer or a question to ponder, you might want to comment in, you might not want to, is what difficult or painful circumstances have you known God's protection and incredible love in this morning? It'd be great to read some of those and hear, I guess, testimony of that. But I guess, well, before we do it, let's quieten our hearts and focus on the psalm that we're about to read. Let me just pray. Lord Jesus, I pray that as we look at this psalm, and whenever people are reading that and watching this video today, Lord, that you would speak to them through your word. Father, that you would just glaringly shine out things from this passage that are for them today, and for further on from today as well, in their week and in their months to come, Lord Jesus. Lord, would you open up our hearts and minds to your word, we pray, in your name. Amen. So let me read this psalm. And just as you're doing that, just think what just really stands out to you as well, and what really speaks to you today. So, hear a just cause, O Lord, attend to my cry, give ear to my prayer from lips free of deceit. From your presence let my vindication come, let your eyes behold the right. You have tried my heart, you have visited me by night, you have tested me and you will find nothing. I have purposed that my mouth will not transgress. With regard to the works of man, by the word of your lips, I have avoided the ways of the violent. My steps have held fast to your paths, my feet have not slipped. I call upon you, for you will answer me, O God. Incline your ear to me, hear my words. Wondrously show your steadfast love, O Saviour of those who seek refuge from their adversaries at your right hand. Keep me as the apple of your eye, hide me in the shadow of your wings, from the wicked who do me violence, my deadly enemies who surround me. They close their hearts to pity, with their mouths they speak arrogantly. They have now surrounded our steps, they set their eyes to cast us to the ground. He is like a lion eager to tear, as a young lion lurking in ambush. Arise, O Lord, confront him, subdue him. Deliver my soul from the wicked by your sword, from men by your hand, O Lord, from men of the world whose portion is in this life. You fill their womb with treasure. They are satisfied with children, and they leave their abundance to their infants. As for me, I shall behold your face in righteousness. When I wake, I shall be satisfied with your likeness. Just take a few seconds just to allow that to soak in and just for any thoughts to come to mind. So I am going to focus in on particularly verse 8. But I want us to just kind of go through this psalm and get every part of it really. But then to focus in on the application on that verse 8 there. And as I said before, just comment in what speaks to you in this passage, what stands out to you. And also what difficult or painful circumstances have you known God's protection and incredible love. And it'd be great to hear testimony of some of those this morning. So verse 1 and 2 here, we see how David he feels innocent and he's crying out to God, give me this vindication, this is false accusation, I'm being persecuted for something that I've not even done. And in saying, he's kind of saying basically, he said, behold the right, he's saying, I am right, I know that I've not done anything. He's wanting his innocence as well to be brought into the light for everyone to see this. And in verses 3 to 5, he carries on in this innocence. And he talks about the heart and the mouth and the I think it's the words as well, yeah. And the way, sorry. So the heart is like the motives. The mouth, it represents like words, or in this case, the lies he's been accused of. And the works as well, it says here. Of man, and that represents kind of the actions, and so these are like the things that he's claiming innocence in. He's innocent in his heart, he's innocent in the words that he's been speaking, he's innocent in what he's been doing, and he also in here gives praise to God for the why he's been able to do that. He's not saying he's perfect though, but he's saying, I've been able to do this because the word of your lips and of holding fast to God. You know, he's not perfect, you know, and we know that David slipped up, as we all do, but he kept to God's leading, and he acknowledged his sins, and because he even says here, he's like, he's open to God's, well, it says, tried my heart, tested me, and purposed that my mouth will not transgress. And he's attempting to stay pure. David is wanting to stay pure in God. You know, he even says as well, I avoided the ways of the violent as well. He feels he's taken everything possible, every step possible to stay away from what he's been accused of. He even says, and the last part of verse 5, my feet have not slipped. He feels he's not slipped away from this closeness with God. And this pure heart that is, well, his heart is seeking to be pure, repenting and seeking forgiveness in all things. And then we go on to verses 6 to 9, which includes the verse I'm going to major on. And it's David basically seeking refuge in God and then saying why he's doing that. He's basically saying, God, I know you listen to me. I know you care about me. Please just show me your love and I know you're a saviour of those who seek refuge. I know, Lord, that you save those who do seek refuge in you. And he's just asking to be saved from these adversaries or these foes, depending on your translation. And then it says this phrase here. I'm going to read verse 8 out again. It says, keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. Apple of your eye. And we think about the apple of your eye like, oh, they're your favourite, don't we? But here this is meaning kind of like you're in God's focus. You know, you're one of his faithful. You are protected by him. And this links into the shadow of your wings then, because it says, protect me. It's basically David saying, protect me. And it says, hide me, but protect me in the shadow of your wings. And this just makes me think of a bird protecting its young, its chicks underneath its wing. It's a place of safety. It's a place where these chicks would feel protected, would feel safe. And this is used by Moses similarly as well in Deuteronomy 32. And this is common in the animal kingdom as well, how we see the protection of young by the mother or the father, often they're the mother. And I saw, I don't know how I stumbled across this, but I came across this random video on YouTube. I don't know why I ended up watching it, but I don't really do Facebook scrolling, but I got drawn in by it that day, certainly, anyway. And it was of this place where these chicks and its mother, this chicken, were being kept. And then a snake comes into this, ends up coming into this place where they were in. And these chicks and the chicken couldn't escape. And it was amazing, although the chicken could have quite easily been killed by the snake, she fully protected the chicks, even being like bravest to go at the enemy of the snake, risking her own life for these chicks. And that just sprung to my mind when I was preparing this passage, of like extreme protection over these chicks, and even when the enemy was striking, that this chicken was prepared to protect her chicks at all costs. And that's like God as well, although the enemy can't kill God, like the snake could have killed the chicken. But it's the same principle, that protection, that going all out to protect us, to care for us, to keep us safe from the enemy. But we've got to hide in the shadow of his wings. We've got to be willing to come to him for our protection, not be out there on our own, doing it on our own, as it were. And then in verse 10 to 12, here we see how David feels that his enemies have no pity. They don't even care what they're doing. They don't care about that they're basically going off lies and deceit and going after an innocent man. And they've got closed hearts, it says here. They close their hearts to pity. They've got arrogant speech and they're ready to harm, basically. They're ready to destroy him. Basically, it gives this picture like a lion, doesn't it? And then in verses 13 to 15, we see how David calls the Lord to, you know, arise. Now, I always find this phrase funny, arise. It makes me think like God's been sitting on his backside doing nothing, and then, oh, suddenly arise, oh, God's come to do something. Well, that is certainly not the case. That is not what it means. But he's asking, David is asking here for God to, you know, show yourself in power. God, come and please do something about my foes here who are persecuting me. He's basically saying, God, defeat them as only you can. As, you know, they're clearly not repenting here, as we saw in verse 10. You know, they closed their hearts to pity. I know you've defeated all powers and authorities. Come and free me and find me as I am innocent. You know, vindicate me, deliver me from this evil. You know, he says these worldly men, you know, whose portion is in this life. That's meaning, you know, they have all the power and the position and treasures and children that they're going to have in the world. That's all they've got. And this gets passed on to their offspring, maybe. And they, as they die, they have none of it. They can take none of that away with them. What they have in this world stays in this world. And that's the same for all of us. David acknowledges that. And sometimes it can be hard for us, though, to understand why has God allowed these kind of people to have this power, this position. You might look at some of our world leaders and go, why has God allowed some of these people to have this power and this position? Or why have they had such a cushy, nice life and I've had such a difficult life? And it can be hard to understand and to come to grips with that. But you've got to remember that they can't take any of that with them. That's all they've got. They've got nothing after death, but we do. You know, we must put our hope, and we must not put our hope and our expectation in the joy of worldly achievements or things, but in a close relationship with God that lasts an eternity. Because verse 15 says, as for me, I shall behold your face in righteousness, so in the presence of God. When I awake, I shall be satisfied with your likeness, satisfied in God's presence for eternity. And I know Jamie alluded to this a bit yesterday in Psalm 16, the confidence that we can have in the fact that we will have eternal presence, eternity in the presence of God, and that David and we have this inheritance. It's an amazing inheritance. You know, this psalm is finishing in triumph, looking forward to the eternity in God's presence. Behold your face, it says. And when I wake, it is referring to the resurrection from the sleep of its earthly death. You know, as I alluded to earlier, we all need, we have all we need. You know, we are satisfied with your likeness, with God's likeness. That's all we need. We can be satisfied with the eternal, everlasting presence of God that we will be in, that we will find. It's like pure bliss. But I do want to focus, though, on this protection in the shadow of God's wings. And just keep commenting in, guys, what stood out to you in this passage, and how God's incredible love and protection has been with you in life's difficult and painful circumstances. But from this verse here, keep me as the apple of your eye, hide me in the shadow of your wings. You know, that makes me think of just how God helps us through troubles and painful circumstances, as well as from them. Sometimes we think, oh God, just get this away from me, deliver me from this, take me away from it. But actually, you know, we don't often realise what God is doing in those times. And although he does want to deliver us from them, often there's a purpose in the reason why we're going through these. But it's important to remember that in these times, God has not abandoned us. God has not gone anywhere. God is not sitting on his blessed assurance, not even bothered about us. He is there. He is with us. He protects us and keeps us safe through these difficult and painful circumstances. You know, for some, lockdown has been an incredibly painful and difficult time, whether that's because of death, maybe that's through finances have been difficult, mental health has been a struggle, or all of the above, or other things too. But it's important to remember that God's protection and safety is still there for you, even though you're going through something right now, maybe. You know, when me and my wife, we had a miscarriage last year, and that was incredibly painful and difficult in some ways. But you know what? We just felt such the protection and incredible love of God in this painful time. It was just amazing. I can't even describe what it was like, or yeah, just can't put it into words, but I just knew it was God, and I had, and we had such a comfort and felt such an amazing love in him. We felt protected, we felt safe, even through this painful circumstance. He didn't take it away, he didn't resurrect this baby. You know, we still lost that baby, we still had that miscarriage, but he helped us through and in that painful circumstance, and he can do that for you too, and he does that for you too. Now, we have a promise here and a wonderful picture in this verse of finding protection and safety under the wings of God. You know, remember, like I said, just it doesn't often take them away like that when we ask for them. He often just uses them, though, to grow us and to teach us and to renew us and to strengthen us. You know, I grew and learned so much from that experience last year, and I know Amy did too, and we're continually growing and learning, but certainly in those times we just have God to depend on. That's all we have in those circumstances, don't we? It's so important to depend and rely upon him in those times, going to him for our protection, for our safety. That is where we can find it. You know, when we have these difficult, painful circumstances, as well as crying out to him for this protection and help, you know, we need to ask God throughout it and after it, you know, what are you teaching me? What are you challenging me in, God? What are you showing me? What do I need to grow in and learn from this? You know, and these are most likely questions that we are, or could be and should be asking God now as we start to come out of lockdown, so we don't just go back to normal life, as it were, as it was before. You know, we want to come out of this time changed, we want to come out of it renewed, we want to come out of it closer to God than ever before, knowing him closer and closer, knowing where and what God is leading us into or away from. And as I was coming to conclusion this morning, what just stands out to me and just spoke to me, which kind of links into what I was saying on Friday at Eden when I was on with Josh, is about our response to these difficult and painful circumstances. It should be different to those who are in the world. You know, we still have a joy and a hope in God, with him being there with us through anything and into eternity. We are secure in him. And certainly throughout my name is miscarriage, you know, I was able to be an example of what it looks like to have joy and hope even in a time of difficulty. And it was a witness to others. I know at my place of work it was. And, you know, that's where it should be. Our response to these difficult and painful circumstances, having a joy and a hope in God still, should be a witness to those around us, even though it is incredibly tough. I'm not saying don't feel sad. I'm not saying it isn't going to be a struggle. But I'm saying how we respond to it should be different, because of what we have in God. Because it's not a worldly response, it's a God honouring, it's a Christ-like response. So in these painful difficulties and circumstances that you might have, maybe you're going through them right now, or maybe they are to come, you know, we have more than this world to have joy and hope in. And in the difficulties of this world, that kind of challenge you to respond differently. Let me just pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that throughout and in and even after difficult and painful circumstances in our lives, Lord Jesus, you promise to be there for us. You promise to protect us and to strengthen us and to just pour your incredible love upon us. And we thank you, Lord, that in the shadow of your wings we can find this refuge, this safety, this protection. But Lord, we thank you that we have more than this life to hope in and find joy in. Lord God, we have eternal bliss of spending our eternity in your presence, Lord God, to look forward to. But Lord, we can also enjoy that now, knowing your love, incredible, amazing love, your incredible presence within us now through your Holy Spirit, and the hope and the joy that that brings, Lord Jesus. Help us to know that and feel that today, as we maybe are struggling with difficult and painful circumstances. Help us to know a sense of protection in the shadow of your wings and the care and the love that you have for us as you help us through these times. Just be with us, we pray today, whatever life throws at us. Lord, be our protection. Shelter us in the shadow of your wings. In your name. Amen. Amen, guys. Sorry it's been a bit of a long one. I hope you've got lots from that, guys. Don't forget to look out for the Coronagate playlist song at 12 as well today. And remember, you are in the shadow of his wings. So respond differently. I hope you have a great day, guys. And I will catch you soon. Bye, guys.